Friends and relatives, first and foremost, I'd like to thank each and every one of you for being here to be a part of this service, for your countless efforts to reach out, let the family know that you're condoling with them in this process that they will be going through. It's just something that we didn't really plan on. You know, no one really plans on these things, but just an untimely thing. But there's so many people that knew Colby who have reached out to the family by phone, by text messaging, other relatives and places and people that he was a part of and alive, that he lived here on this earth. So we're going to go ahead and begin our service here today. I'm going to open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, you who gave us life and then received us again in death, we thank you for always being there for us and for the grace you give us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Dear Lord, we ask you to be here with us, with the family, dear Lord, as we use this time to memorialize the life of our brother, nephew, grandson, Colby Armstrong. Dear Lord, that we come to you with heavy hearts, filled with grief. Dear Lord, we ask you just to ease those feelings with the comfort only you can bring. Dear Lord, we relish in the fact that your Son, Jesus Christ, defeated death, and we know what waits for us on the other side, dear Lord. And we're thankful for all these many blessings you've given us, dear Lord. We're thankful for this life that you've given here to us, dear Lord, on this earth, even for a short time, dear Lord. It's impacted so much, and his name, his life, his legacy will live on, dear Lord. Dear Lord, we ask you to be with us now through the service. Be with each and every one of us, dear Lord. We ask all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Going to ask Brother Brian Stoner if he could lead us in a couple of Ponca hymns.
One be there, Jesus, anyway, God.
there's just a portion here I want to dedicate to some of these relatives, friends, you know, those who knew Colby best. You know, it wasn't like having a friend, it was like having a brother around. Likewise in other relationship statuses, you know, he was always there for one another, always there for whoever it was that relationship was built upon. And it was kind of like the way that he lived his life. He was a infectious, happy-go-lucky kind of person. And it seemed like no matter where he was, no matter where he went, he made these relationships. Made these relationships with people he worked with, people he was around all the time. And it shows over to how much of a blessing he was to a lot of his relatives that he made here on this earth. And Uncle Sid asked me if I would share just a couple of these little sentiments that were sent to him and a family that were from some of the people that he worked with when he was up north. So these are their words and not mine. The opening remark was, Colby Jack Cheese, miss your infectious smile. You've been a beacon for so many. I miss you, and I'm so lucky to have a friend and a mentor like you. We will all miss you, Manda. This one says, Colby, my fave. I miss you so much. You were always my fave. I miss you giving me grief every day. I miss your smile and your awesome personality. You're an amazing guy with the biggest heart. Jen. Says, this one just says, Colby, no judging my great art. Made with care, buddy. We miss you a lot. Think of you often. And I must say, I now say this, glad you got to see me. Not. Stay strong. Lots of hugs from Robin. Enclosed was a picture of some of his friends that he worked with up there at this this camp. You know, I have a, just like many people that knew Colby, you know, when I, this is the way I met him. We just had moved home back from Arizona, and we're going to enroll over here in Ponca School. And Colby is one of the first people that I met, introduced himself, and you know, we became friends right off the bat because we started having common interests of stuff. We were both into sports. We liked a lot of the same things. We liked the same music. And then we'd always say, you know, well, come over and visit, you know. Come over to the house where they lived at over there in Ponca. And so we had a good relationship that way. Rolled over with Brother Clint here. This is my little brother Clint, and me and Clint became good friends as well. You know, we all had that same thing, and you can't tell by today, but I used to give Colby and Clint a run for the money back in the day when we played sports. I think that was one of my favorite memories of Colby was he was the fastest person. He could play football, run track, basketball, everything. He was fast. And then one track meet we went to, I think we went to Thomas, Oklahoma, and you know, I was a lot skinnier, of course, and I did run, but I didn't run long distance, and Colby did, and then a couple of the kids we went with, they got sick on the way over, and they couldn't do the 1 mile relay, and the coach says, we need volunteers. First one was Colby. Yeah. Colby stood up, so I said, well, if he's doing it, I'm doing it too. You know, all I did was a 100-yard meter, shot put, and discus. So there we were, and we all lined up, and they told us to have a foot race to get the fastest times for the mile. And, you know, we ran the length of the football field, and when we took off, you know, I just gave it all I got, ran. And I had beat Colby, and he was upset about it, but he was still happy at the same time. So we competed in Thomas with the unlikely crew of four people to run the 1 mile relay. And I think we got second or third. So it was a good matchup, but I was always happy for the things we did like that. You know, Colby was that type of guy that, like I said, he can go anywhere, and within seconds he had a best friend. They would he was that person that could adapt to any situation, adapt to any kind of type of way of life of whoever he was around. He was that solid friend, could be a mentor, could be a counselor, or it could be someone who could tease you relentlessly and joke with you and have all the best laughs that you could ever have. You know, it was very difficult there that time, you know, when we were friends, and then this is where it comes into being the funny part. You know, they talked about it before, and we never really established a relationship beyond friendship. And it was a death that brought us all together, and we were down at a funeral in Oto, down at the Culture Center. And I'm sitting there, and of course I seen Uncle Sid, and I seen all the rest of the family. And then here comes Clint and Colby come walking in. And we saw each other, and we kind of both laughed and smiled about it. And I was like, what are you doing here? And they're like, oh, you know, this is our relative too. And I said, oh, really? I said, I'm sorry, I didn't know that. You know, you guys were part Oto. He said, yeah, we told you we were part Oto, part Ponca. And then I said, oh, yeah, well, let me go talk to my grandma real quick. Grandma Ada had just walked in. And Colby looked at me. He said, that's my grandma. So we both go running up to Grandma Ada. I'm filled with a lot of questions. And he's looking at her the same way. And he goes, how are you his? We was like the same time. How are you his grandma? And then Grandma Ada, she just let out that big laugh. She goes, you boys don't know you're related? And that's when it, you know, our friendship became stronger, you know. You know, like I said, he was truly a brother to me, him. Clint's truly my little brother. And that's how we strengthened our relationship the entire time we were together, you know. And it was funny that we would go back and tell people, and then we start calling each other brother, it's my cousin, you know, showing a relationship, and everybody's all looking at us weird, and we're like, it's a long story, but, you know, this is how it came to be. But, you know, it was good, but it was better to learn a lot of things. In my life, it was to relearn the relationships with all my younger relatives. I knew all my older relatives moving away, but I didn't know all my younger relatives, and I was so happy and blessed to have Brother Colby and Brother Clint in my life, always to rely upon them over these years. I'm going to ask Brother Derek if he could sing us a Ponca hymn.
Oh,
upon you as well. Elaborate here for maybe some of the people who are watching and different relatives who are not here. These songs, that Brother Brian, Brother Derek, Brother Brent had sing, these are in our Ponca tribe. We had some of the greatest song composers, and they had made songs for everything, songs for celebrations, for life, and for around that big drum. But they also embraced the fact of God and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. And they created these Ponca hymns that were sung here today. And they were made from the Ponca Indian Methodist Church, the Ponca Nazarene Church, and the Ponca Baptist Church. These churches, there's a couple other churches as well as Ponca Full Gospel, and then as well as the Native American Church. A lot of these songs were composed by individuals from these back in the early 40s and 50s, and some to present day. They're all talking about praising God, and then also asking God in to have compassion upon us. You know, the very first song, Brother Brian sang, the words simply mean just asking God the Savior to come at this very point, at this very place, at this very time, and comfort us. And this is what these, in these songs, in different ways, in different fashions, they're formed, they're made to be that way, to be a praise to God and His Son, Jesus Christ. We're going to have a reading of the obituary. I ask you now to come.
I've been asked to read Colby's obituary. I'm Wendy, his sister-in-law. Colby James Armstrong, also known by his Ponca native name, Wega Sapi, 41, of Boise, Idaho, and most recently Coss City, Oklahoma, left this life on January 5th, 2024, surrounded by his loving family. Colby was born on October 1st, 1982 in Ponca City, Oklahoma, to Sidney Armstrong and Shelley Avey. Colby attended school in Tonkawa, Oklahoma, before the family moved to Kuna, Idaho, where he finished school at Kuna High School. Colby met Amanda Scott of Kuna, Idaho, and had two beautiful daughters, Palin and Henley Armstrong. Colby worked in various industries before being employed as an assistant manager for the Idaho Youth Ranch, where he thought of his co-workers as his extended family. He enjoyed fishing, golfing, reading, and watching the Oklahoma Sooners win. Colby is survived by his daughters, Palin and Henley of Kuna, Idaho, Father Sidney Armstrong and his wife Angelica of Ponca City, Oklahoma, Mother Shelley Avey and her husband Glenn of Caw City, Oklahoma, Brothers Clint Armstrong of Tonkawa, Oklahoma, Ian Avey and his wife Amanda of Duncan, Oklahoma, Pascal and his wife Wendy Blumel of Bartlesville, Oklahoma, Sister Janine Barnett of Bremen, Germany, Grandfather Larry Goodnow Sr. of Peckham, Oklahoma, and numerous aunts, uncles, nephews, and nieces. He was preceded in death by his parents, by his grandparents, Bill and Ada Grant and Connie Goodnow. In lieu of flowers, memorial contributions may be made to Hospice of North Central Oklahoma, 445 Fairview Avenue, Ponca City, Oklahoma, 74601.
At this time, we want to give a short portion to anybody that want to say anything to the family, maybe share a memory or remark about something that Colby had given to you or shared with you or helped you along the way to help with this time in passing. So I'm going to leave it open just for a short portion here.
To the family here, I didn't know Colby, but what I've heard, he touched a lot of lives. He lived a good life. And I'm sure that his aunt and uncles and brothers and sisters, grandparents were all proud of him. You know, like was said, we never know what's going to happen. God has a plan for all of us. We don't know what that plan is. We leave it up to Him. But I can say, God makes everything new. Colby is new today. He's celebrating with his grandparents and the many people that have gone on before him, yeah. Relatives. We're going to mourn. We're going to grieve. But we have a God who loves us, who's going to help us through this time. My heart is heavy for my brother Sid. Colby is the kind of person what I've heard say about him is someone that you wish you could have met and enjoyed your time with him. Laughter, friendship, relationship. I can't say much more other than that we have a God, we have a loving God who loves us. And family, I want you to know that in times like this, He says that He'll never leave us. He's going to comfort you. He's going to give you strength. When times are hard, which they will be, kneel down and talk to Him. He'll help you. God bless you. Bless your homes. Bless your family, brother.
I didn't get to spend as much time with Colby as I wish I had liked to, you know, living in a different state as him, but he was always so welcoming, even when time has passed, the first time I even met him too, you just feel like you've always been friends with him and you've always known this person. He's such a vibrant personality. And I don't know, just I think my favorite memory of him is going to be mine and Pascal's wedding at the reception. He hardly knew anybody there. You know, he knew a little bit of the family and you know, that was it. And he made so many friends there, just dancing the night away and not caring, you know, what people thought. He had amazing dance moves too, by the way, talking about just being so vibrant in the life of the party. And I mean, just welcomed everybody and treated everybody like he's just known you forever. And I wish I would have gotten to spend more time with him than what we did, but he'll definitely be missed by all of us. We're thinking of you two especially, and keeping you in our prayers.
Thank you.
And I'd like to get up and make an expression on behalf of my family here. But Colby, his nickname was Cotton. He had real blonde hair. Call him Cotton, that's what my dad named him. So I quit. His name was Boogie Red. And we all grew up with nicknames like that. But with Kobe, Clint, my sons, all of my nephews, my brothers, kids, sisters, kids and sons like that, we're all very, very close. It's like closer than what a nephew would be. Call him son. All of my nephews, I call them sons because that's what they are to me. The son here, he's going to be truly missed. He was real close with TJ, just like Clint. Always bringing up stories about when they grew up, about what they did. A lot of it they thought I didn't know about, but I knew about it. Anyway, I can't say enough about the love that we had for him. And that you can be assured that we have a promise. That promise is that we will see each other again. We will be with one another again. That's a promise that was made to us. Jesus, God Almighty, they tell us that one of these days that we're all going to be together again. So my brother Garland was talking about everything is new. Everything is... Corky's not sick no more. There's no pain. There's no darkness. No sickness. This is that place that we all strive to get to. So I just wanted to stand up, let my family know, my friends and relatives know how close that we were. My brother's sons, my sister's sons, are my sons. The same way with them. That's the way we treat each other. So I know that if there was a way around this, we would have known about it. They would have told us about it. We, each and every one of us, going to have to go through this. And I ask that, what it is, that time, you know, that we can learn to lean. To lean on God, to lean on each other, to get through this together.
Yeah.
Always be good. yourself. I just wanted to let my folks know that I love each and every one of you. I'm not sure I'm going to miss Cotton. Oh God, to bless each and every one of you, your families, your children, your homes like that, that you can receive a blessing. I hope.
Just like many of you, I know we were all shocked to hear that this untimely passing, but it didn't shock me when Uncle Sid had told me how he was, even in sickness, how strong he was, how he, even after the doctors had said what they had said, and he surpassed those the amount of time that he was given. Everything was stacked up against him, but yet he was strong to the very end. It says a lot about him, people that he came from, our relatives that the blood that ran through his veins, ran through his as well. I talked about how we met and the grandmas that we had, the relationship that was given to us is that his grandmother, Grandma Ada Grant, and my grandmother, Rachel Makes Cry Primo, they grew up within a mile radius from their homestead and our homestead out west. My grandmother passed when I was very young, but it was in our relatives like Grandma Ada and other ones that had strengthened the memory about how their childhood was when they grew up. And it was only fitting that the memory I could bring up about Grandma Ada was, she told me, she said, even though we were cousins, we were like sisters. And she said, let me take that back. She said, we were like sisters, but we were each other's best friend. And I thought about that, and I shared that with Colby, and I shared that with Clint about, from where we came from. It was on our Ponca side, the relationship that we had, it was strong. We were intended to find each other in life. We were intended to find each other to become these friends and become relatives that knew each other once again. And I was always proud of that. Proud of that relationship I had with the Grant family, with Uncle Sid and all my relatives, that's where we come from. And the closeness that the grandmothers that we had, how they were with one another. And she told me, she said, to always remain strong in your relatives. Your relatives can only help you so much and carry you in times of need. That's why when I was told and Uncle Sid had asked me to be a part of the service in this capacity, I was deeply honored. I was sad and upset, but I knew and comforting to know exactly, like what was said, of where he is. I'm glad I could lean upon the relationship I have with God and where, and the ways that I have been taught through our the ways of strengthening our relationship with God. Each day we're to remember that we're no more nor less than we were the day before, and we can only increase our chance to strengthen that bond we have with God and the people that are around us. One thing I always heard and always relished and put in my memory when everything was said and done was people would always say, only you can change the outcome of who you are. No matter where you are in life, whatever happens to you in life, only you can change and be the finishing author of your story. And Colby did that. He remained strong until the end. He was a very proud person. You know, it didn't push or sway my thoughts or ideas of what he said and the way he had talked with Uncle Sid about what he wanted done, how he wanted these service to be conducted. It takes a strong man to realize that in the end, when sickness hits you, that, you know, it's inevitable that death will come to you. But it seems like Colby welcomed death, you know, in a good way that he had, and the strong heart that he had. I'm sure he, in the end, he made in a relationship, a friendship with death itself. That's why it took him. It took him so gently and so peacefully from this earth that we didn't even know the difference. Like Brother Clint said, he goes, I left him for a minute. When I came back, he was already gone. So we must rejoice in the fact that in that time, God seen to him. There was no other cure, earthly cure, that he could have given him, but the cure to bring him to his everlasting home in heaven. Of course, as just human beings, it's hard to understand the will of God sometimes. Sometimes we question the faith of God, of why he does certain things and certain things happen to certain people, but that is just us being human. It's not you being doubtful or being any type of way towards God. You know, I think about the Apostle John. He tells in his book that the reaction of Jesus when hearing that his friend Lazarus had died. And we've learned it's many who don't even know the Bible have heard that the shortest verse in the entire Bible is in that story with Lazarus when it said Jesus wept. Not cried. Not felt bad. But Jesus wept. And upon further translation of what they're trying to say when it, the word came to us, wept, in a mournful state. He didn't just cry a little bit. He let out his grief. And he mourned. He sobbed the passing of his friend. But being Jesus, the Son of God, he had a lesson in the death that he brought Lazarus back. To show us all that he is the conqueror of death, not death. And in the fact that when he too had died, he made a way for us. He made a way for us that when it is our time to leave, he had made a way for us over there with our folks. And thinking about the, I always think about the first few minutes in where we go to and in this place called heaven. You know, I know what the Bible says it is, and I know the description that was given, but to me and my thoughts and what I hope it is, you know, I don't care for fancy palaces and golden streets. I told someone before, I somewhat dirt roads and hills and valleys and rivers. I want to be able to go there and just see everybody and look at them and know who you are and know my relationship with you. To have a conversation without even having a word. That's heaven. To be with everybody, no matter if we come from different nationalities, no matter if we come from different backgrounds, whatever language we may go to heaven and speaking, when we talk with one another, we'll know each other's language. We'll hear it. And we'll hear the beauty and simplicity of all the words and songs that were made before us. And some of these words that were made, and some of these songs that were made by some of our own relatives. Because Brother Colby comes from some strong people. His great-grandfather, Grandpa David Eagle. And I talked with Uncle Sid too, just sharing up the things on the Ponca side, coming from our Vihida clan, the blood clan of the Ponca tribe. And that says even more about the character because of the men that produced, like Grandpa David, and others that were there, and his spinning name, Wegasapi, Iron Whip. The man that carried that name was a strong spokesman of the people, was a strong person for God and everything, but he was adamant in his ways of life, what he did while he was here, and how he was seen and how he was a friend to others. So it is only fitting that that was the name he carried on this earth, and that's the name that he will hear when he reaches that place over there to be with all our relatives. So again, I know we're hurting, I know we're sad, but this sadness to us seems like a while, but for those on the other side, it's just a little bit. When we leave this place and leave this time, you know, we rejoin with them. Like nothing's ever gone with us. No years have passed, no days, no times, no hour, but we'll be back with them. And we just got to remember to strengthen our bond, strengthen our walk in daily life with God. So I ask you all to please keep the family in your prayers through this next couple of days and difficult times. I ask you to remember his children, Palin and Henley, because it is your duty now to always let them know when they need to know something about who their father was and the type of person he was. To know, Brother Clint, when they say something, you could turn and say with a smile, your daddy was this, your daddy was that. Yeah. And that's the thing that's going to be the most to them. Although they didn't get to know their dad for a great amount of time, we have that duty upon our lives now to keep his memory and his life, which shall never fade. So thank you all for your time and being here and to be a part of this service in whatever shape and form you did. And those who came here as just being a comfort to the family, it shows in your presence, even though you had nothing to say, maybe you had the thoughts and ideas of wanting to confess something, to say something. But your presence alone shows that you are here to stand with the family in the hardest point in life when it comes to this grief. And we thank you all. I'm going to close with the word of prayer. Our precious Heavenly Father, dear Lord, we ask you to bless us, everybody here in this service, dear Lord. Send blessings upon to all of the many households that represent and celebrating in the memory of this life of your loved one here, your son that you've called home, Colby. Dear Lord, we relish in the fact that he had a good faith and relationship with you, dear Lord. We know that all is well, all is at peace. All is good with his soul, dear Lord. Dear Lord, we are just but mere human beings and don't understand a lot of things, and grief is sometimes a hard thing to go through. Dear Lord, it causes doubt, causes things, but we ask that you to ease our comfort, ease into this grief that we're going through, to comfort us and be with us, dear Lord, to abide with us and help us along. Dear Lord, you know, with our love and our memories that we have, it's hard to see an end to a day where there's no crying and no more sadness, but there is an end, dear Lord, and only you can help us and guide us to that place and time, dear Lord. Be with each and every one of us, dear Lord, and from the youngest to the oldest, dear Lord. Be with us now, dear Lord, and at the conclusion of service, dismiss us from this place, but not from your presence. We ask all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen.